You can be seated. There's a game that I play almost every day of my life, and yet it's a weird game. It's a strange game, and you may play this same game in your own life. There's no field to play this game on. There's no equipment or pieces that go with the game. There's really no winner in this game, which is pretty amazing, because why would you play the game if there's no winner? But I play this game. There's no trophy in this game. There's just really no point in this game, and yet I play this game constantly. As a matter of fact, I would be a professional at this game. And maybe you would be a professional at this game as well. You say, well, what is that? It doesn't make any sense. Well, it's called the comparison game. Anybody ever played that game before? It's a game that I started early in my life, and maybe you did as well. My earliest recollection of this game would be on the playground as a kid. And maybe we were kind of playing and talking or whatever, and one guy would say, yeah, my dad is the CEO of his corporation. And I would say, yeah, my dad owns this city. You ever played that game? Or maybe it came a different way. Maybe they said, yeah, our family got a new car, and you said, yeah, my family owns the car lot. You know, and you just kind of played the comparison game until you could finally win the game. But it started pretty early. Some people call this the one-upsmanship, where you one-up somebody that if they get out ahead of you, then you've got to do something to try to get out ahead of them. Sometimes it comes in the form of our looks, where we strive to look better than other people or to dress nicer than other people. And, you know, again, there's nothing wrong with that, but we kind of compare ourselves, and are you in front of me, and I got to catch up with you, and in a way, it becomes almost a competition. But I call it the comparison game. It's exhausting, though. It's a game, as we said earlier, there's really no winner. You don't get a trophy. You don't get a championship. If you're a sports fan today, isn't the ultimate to get the championship, right? Many of us have football teams that have kicked off, and we're excited about the new year, and you want your team to get the trophy and the championship, and yet this is a game where you can't get the championship. But it's exhausting. It's frustrating. As a matter of fact, if you want to write this down, to compare brings despair. When we compare our lives to the lives of the other people around us, it just brings about despair. Often in my life, again, I told you I struggle with this, and I'm just confessing this to you this morning, is I look at other people around me, and I want to measure up, or I want to exceed what they're doing. Maybe for you, it kind of is similar to this, but I'll look at people to my right, and I'll look at people to my left, and I'll look at people as I'm driving up the street, when I'm walking through a mall or into a restaurant, and in my head, there's this calculation, okay, I got them beat, or oh gosh, they beat me here. And so we play this comparison game, and we're trying to decide who wins and who loses, and really nobody wins. To compare really brings despair. But what we're going to find today is that for every struggle that we have, God has the answer. For every struggle that we come in today and we bring into this place today, God has an answer for that. And he has an answer for what we struggle with here. And if you got your Bibles, you can turn to 2 Corinthians 10, because he kind of addresses this whole idea of the comparison game. And this thing where we look to the people to the left, and we look to the people to the right, and the people behind us and in front of us, and we kind of try to gauge, how am I doing? Well, in 2 Corinthians 10, that was happening, and a guy named Paul, if you're a Christian today and you know about God's Word, then you know this guy named Paul. If you're not a Christian, or maybe you're new to Christianity, and maybe you don't know Paul, but he wrote a lot of what we read in the Bible. And he's a great teacher. He's a great mentor. His lessons have been used in every industry of our world. It's just good stuff that he shares with us in Scripture. And today in 2 Corinthians, what was happening to him is he was being compared. There was a competing kind of Christian group, and they were looking at him and saying, you know what, you're not as impressive as we thought. Your writings and your teachings and what you do is not that great. Now, if you remember, Paul goes on to just do phenomenal things in our world. As a matter of fact, there are cathedrals built for Paul. In most major cities, you'll find a St. Paul's Cathedral. All over the world, St. Paul is now revered as one of the great figures in our universe. And yet at this point in time, there were people kind of dinging Paul, saying, "You're not that impressive. You don't speak that well. Your writings aren't that great. And I'm not real impressed with you, Paul." And so Paul kind of came back to them and he said, "Guys, we can't do this. We can't just keep competing against each other. There's no good that'll come from that. There's nothing great that'll come." And so in the teaching we're going to look at today, Paul just looks back at these guys and he says, "Don't do this. I mean, don't play the comparison game. It's not going to help you and it's not going to help me." And really what he was saying, it's not going to help further the gospel. Because Paul was on a mission. If you remember, he had come into a relationship with Christ and he was going all over sharing the gospel. And so Paul looks at these guys and he says, "Stop comparing yourself with me. Stop comparing yourself with other people." He says it's not going to help you in the long run. And so today, I just kind of want to, for the next few moments, I want to just kind of tackle this topic. Because I'm pretty certain that we all compare ourselves to other people. We all kind of have a measure and stick with other people. And if we fall below them, we get frustrated. And if we get above them, we're excited. And Paul says, don't do that. There's no good that can come from that. So if you would, let's bow our heads, let's pray, and let's ask God to be with us today. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that we can learn today. And Lord, what you're going to teach us is so helpful. But God, I pray that we'll accept it today. And what you want to say and what you want to do today in this room will be done. Lord, I just pray that we'll honor you in all we do and say. In Christ's name, amen. Three things in your outline today that we want to learn and what Paul's going to teach us. Number one, avoid comparing yourself with others. Avoid comparing yourself with others. On your outline, we've got this verse in 2 Corinthians 10:12. Here's what it says. We do not dare to classify or compare ourselves with some who commend themselves. Here's what he's saying is, guys, remember he's talking to this religious group and he's saying, guys, we got this wrong. We're comparing ourselves to each other and we're commending ourselves because we got out ahead a little bit of the other one. And he's saying, that's not going to help. Look what he says next. When they measure themselves by themselves and compare themselves with themselves, look at this, they are not wise. They are not wise. Those last two words there are crucial for you and I, crucial for our understanding about this issue, that it's just not wise to compare ourselves with other people. In Scripture, we're told about wisdom, and we're asked to gain wisdom and to have wisdom. And what Paul is saying is if we're going to compare ourselves to other people, then we're actually going backwards, that there's really no wisdom in comparing our lives to the lives of other people. As a matter of fact, in our lives, we constantly need to ask questions like this. Is this the wise thing to do? Is this a wise decision that I'm making? Because wisdom really is the ultimate. It's the premium. Intellect is great, and we all want some intellect, right? But wisdom is the pinnacle. Godly wisdom is really where it's at. And so if you're studying and you're trying to learn, which I do a lot of that myself, that can only take me so far. Intellect can only take us so far. But wisdom is the pinnacle. It's the greatest. And so what we're told here is that it's just not wise to compare ourselves with others. There's just nothing good that can come from it. I found out this morning, I did a little research, and it's actually impossible for you and I to compare ourselves to others. Let me give you some proof of that. Did you know that in the world at this moment, there are 7.3 billion people? Well, you can't compare yourself to all 7.3 billion, right? I mean, that would be impossible. I mean, you might get ahead of a few of them, but you're not going to get ahead of all of them. You say, well, I'm not worried about the world. What about the country? At this moment in America, there are 319 million people. Were you going to compare yourself with all them? I mean, that's going to be a lot of work, right? Can you imagine 319 calculations going through your head? It's just not possible. When you say, well, I'm not worried about the world, and I'm not worried about the country, but I'm worried about the state of Georgia, right? I want to win the state of Georgia. Anybody want to win the state of Georgia? Bad news. There are 10.1 million people here. That's a lot of comparing, right? I mean, there's no way to do it. And so really, if you're comparing your lives and you're looking at the people in front of you and behind you and to the sides and your head's on a swivel trying to figure out how you're doing, it's virtually impossible. And that's why it's frustrating. Because if you ever start down the road of comparing your life to other people's lives, it's just exhausting. And there's no win. There's no victory. There's no trophy. It's impossible to really compare ourselves to other people. So number one, he says, avoid comparing yourself with others. Number two, celebrate other people's successes. Celebrate other people's successes. Now, these next two kind of thoughts that I'm going to throw at you here in a minute, number two and number three, these are the antidote for comparing ourselves to others. This is an antidote for comparing our lives with other people's lives. And if we'll do these next two things, if you'll do number two, and if you'll do this last one that we're going to mention in a moment, if you'll do these two, it's the antidote for the comparison game. Notice what we find here on the outline. It says, our hope is that as your faith continues to grow, our sphere of activity among you will greatly expand so that we can preach the gospel in the regions beyond you. What Paul says is, guys, first of all, quit comparing yourself with me. Paul said, there's just no fruit in that. There's no real win that can happen there. But then he says, guys, here's what we need to do. We need to promote the successes of each other. We need to shoot for success for the other person. And that's what he says here. He says, hope, matter of fact, that's the first two words that we find here, is that our hope. As a matter of fact, if you want to circle that, that's a good thing to hope for. You might not have ever calculated that or thought about that, but our hope ought to be that other people are succeeding. Our hope ought to be that other people are doing well. If you're in an office and the guy next to you in the next office is succeeding, our tendency is to want to kind of crash in on him, right? And to be frustrated with him. And to find a reason not to like that guy. And yet what Paul is saying is celebrate with that guy. I mean, be okay with his successes. Or maybe for you, it's somebody has a wardrobe and it's a little better wardrobe than your wardrobe. And it'd be real easy to kind of say, well, I need to have a better wardrobe or I need to buy better clothes. And yet it's okay for other people to get ahead. It's okay for people to get the promotion. It's okay for somebody to get the new car or to get the new house. It's perfectly okay. And Paul said that's the antidote for playing the comparison game. If you don't want to play the comparison game, one of the ways to kind of chisel back from that mess is to say, I want to celebrate the successes of other people. I've got a project for you this week, okay? Let's try to do this together. And it's real simple. Actually, it's pretty difficult, but it's simple to say, okay? So I'll say it simply. But here's our project this week. How about we all find some people that we want to publicly and out loud praise, okay? And especially those people that we compete with. Let me give you an illustration of this. Maybe it is the guy in the next office beside you. And you do have a competitive nature with that guy. What if you publicly out loud this week to other people said, man, I hope you succeed. I hope you win Salesman of the Year. I hope that you end up on top in our industry. What if you said that to him? Well, that's one of the antidotes for comparing ourselves, to kind of push him back and chiseling away that comparative attitude. So can we do that this week? Just encourage people. Say, I want you to succeed. I want you to go to the top. I want you to be the best. But let me ask you a question, because this is where it gets difficult. Who are you trying to catch up with? Who are you trying to catch up with? I mean, who is it that gets ahead of you and you say, no, I got to catch up to you? Who is it around you or in your life that when they get ahead, you get frustrated? Because I have those people. And again, I have to confess, from an early age, I've played the comparison game. And I've kind of in my head, I thought, you know what? There are about two or three people that if they get ahead of me, I get frustrated. But if I get ahead of them, I get happy. Do you have those people? Do you have a few people around you who you're trying to catch up with? What about praising them this week? What about celebrating their success out loud and publicly and saying, man, good for you. Good job. Again, that's the antidote for comparing our lives to other people's lives. So that's number two, celebrate other people's successes. And then number three, and this is the key, remember whose you are. Remember whose you are. One of the challenges with the comparison game is often we use people as our measuring stick. We look at other people and we say, you know what, I have to meet or exceed that person. And what we're going to learn in just a moment, that's the wrong measuring stick. That's the wrong measurement for our own personal lives. If you have your outline or your Bible, look what we find in verse 17. But, if you ever see but in Scripture, you'll know that the next thing coming is important. That this is kind of the key or a crucial statement. So here it is. Here's the crucial statement. Let the one who boasts boast in the Lord. For it is not the one who commends himself. Let's stop there for a second. If I achieve and I say, Jody, you did fantastic, and everybody kind of applauds me and says, man, you're doing great, that's not enough. That's what he says. If everybody in here today, matter of fact, if you want to do this after the service, you can. If everybody pats me on the back and says, you are great. Listen. That's not enough. Look what he says. Let the one who boasts, boast in the Lord. For it is not the one who commends himself who is approved. Look at this. But the one whom the Lord commends. If everybody in here today came up afterwards and said, great job, I appreciate you. But God said to me, uh-uh. Who wins? It's not about the people around us commending us. The standard, the measuring stick, it shouldn't be people. The measuring stick should be God. And yet often we look at people and we say, I've got to measure up to people, or I've got to get ahead of people, or he got ahead of me, I got to catch up. And that's the wrong measuring stick. The measuring stick for success, or the whatever word you want to use, the measuring stick for how am I doing, it never will come through people. It always will come from God. Look what he says. But let the one who boasts boast in the Lord. For it is not the one who commends himself who is approved, but the one whom the Lord commends. Now, I want to shift it just a little bit and take you to another writing of Paul in Galatians. On your outline there, if you have your Bible, Galatians 4. And again, he speaks to this same kind of thought here. Because what was happening is people were using a yardstick. They were using each other as a yardstick for figuring out how they were doing. And notice what happens here in Galatians 4 on your outline. He says, you are his children. God has sent the Spirit of His Son into your hearts, prompting us to call out, Abba, Father. Now, in the Greek, when you kind of look at that, it means daddy. It's a very personal thought about God. He says, prompting us to call daddy. Now, you are no longer a slave, but you're God's own child. And since you are His child, God has made you His heir. One of the reasons we shouldn't compare ourselves to other people is because of who we are. We're God's child. Did you see that he said that? He said that we're God's child. But not only that, he then goes and says that we're an heir. Notice what we find here at the end of that verse. He says, and since you are his child, God has made you an heir. I looked up the definition of the word heir, and here's what I found. A person who inherits the rank and the title and the position of another. Did you know that when you came into a relationship with Christ, you became an heir? That you, God placed you in a high position? And that you now are not only a child, but you're an heir. As a matter of fact, I wrote it down this way. You're an heir. There's no need to compare. You and I are heirs. There's no reason to compare. we've already been given a high position. We've already been given a high place. And if somebody gets out ahead of me a little, it doesn't matter. There's no need for me to compare myself to that guy because I'm an heir. I'm a child of the King. I'm part of the royal family of the King of God, Kingdom of God. There's no reason for me to compare myself to other people. There's no reason for me to look at the people around me and try to achieve whatever they've achieved. There's no reason for me to look to the left and the right and behind and in front and to drive down the street and what did they buy and what new do they have? Or look in the office next door and what was his raise and what was her bonus? There's no reason to do that. Because I'm an heir. I've been given a high position. I'm an heir. There's no need to compare. So my goal and our hope today is that that gets lodged deep, deep, deep into your heart. Where you look at life and you say, you know what? I don't have to compare. I'm an heir. I don't have to compare. I'm a child of the King. I'm part of the royal family of God. And so what's going to happen this week, just like it's going to happen to me, we're going to be tempted to compare ourselves with somebody. Somebody's going to walk up on us, or somebody's going to come into our office, or somebody's going to give us a call on the phone, and immediately our tendency is to compare what's going on with them and what's going on with us. And our tendency is to use them as the measuring stick. And God's saying, no, don't do that. Use me as the measuring stick. God, am I pleasing you? God, do you commend who I am? Are you pleased with what's going on with me? Because I don't need to compare. I am an heir. Dani Tabor, that sings in here often, she writes a blog, and I just wanted to read some words that she wrote about a year or two ago, I guess it was. In a blog, she wrote this. It was titled, I Am Enough. Here's what she said. In Psalm 63, it speaks about the soul being satisfied as with fat of the rich foods. Do you know how it feels after a heavy meal? You're overwhelmingly stuffed as if you can't fit anything else into your body. That feeling can be duplicated in the spiritual sense. She said, I want that feeling of satisfaction that no man can give to me. Here's what she ended with. I am enough. Nothing and no one can change that. When we're in Christ, we're enough. We're a child. We're an heir. And our tendency is to compare or to ask ourselves, where are we at or what are we up to or how well am I doing? And listen, that's normal to ask those questions. It's really normal for me to ask the question, how am I doing and how do I measure up? But I can't let people help me determine how I measure up. I've got to look to God and say, God, you tell me how I'm measuring up. God, you tell me how I'm doing. God, whatever I'm into and whatever I'm doing, I'm asking for your help. You tell me how I'm doing. God, tell me how I am as a father. God, tell me how I am as a husband. God, tell me how I am as a Christian. You help me, God. Because if I use other people as the measuring stick, he says, you know what? You're gonna mess up. There's just no help there. There's no end there. All that's going to do is exhaust us. There's a movie that you've probably seen, and I've seen it. It's a movie called Elf. Anybody seen that movie before? That great theological movie? It will be in a minute. You'll see. I watched it. I guess it came out maybe in the mid-2000s, maybe 2006, 7, 8, somewhere in there, maybe. And in that movie, there's this great scene, and this scene is quoted quite often. Some of you will remember what happens in that scene. But here is the setup. If you'll remember, the manager is talking to all the employees at this department store. Remember that? And he says, guys, I've got a great announcement for you. Tomorrow is going to be a wonderful day here at the store. He says, Santa Claus is going to be here tomorrow. You remember that part? Anybody remember? And what did Will Ferrell say? Anybody know? I know him. I know him. You remember that? I know him. I know him. And have you ever thought about that's what we can say about our God? That when we're comparing our lives, or maybe we're getting behind and we're not sure about ourselves, maybe it's a week where you're not comfortable with what's going on with your own self. Maybe you feel inferior to other people. Did you know that you can look at your life and say, you know what? But I know Him. I know Him. And it's not the Him that we see here. Because often we want to look at the Hims and the Hers here and say, you know what? I'm not doing so well. But it's only when we say, I know Him, that we can overcome this comparison trap, this comparison game. When we look at our lives and say, you know what? I may be having a rough week. I may not feel good about myself. I may feel like I'm slipping backwards in this whole world that I live in. But we can always come to a place and say, you know what? But I know Him. I know Him. I know who He is. I know what He's done. And I'm leaning in to Him. You are an heir. There's no need to compare. You and I are heirs of the kingdom of God. There's no need for us to compare. Now today we're going to take the Lord's Supper, and it's just a great opportunity for us to be reminded of who we are and who He is. Because when Christ came to the cross, He saw who we were. He knew who we were. And He realized we needed help. And we come to the Lord's Supper, what we're really saying is, God, I can't do this life. I can't make this life work. But God, through Your Son Jesus Christ dying on a cross, it all makes sense. And so when we come to the Lord's Supper, what we're really saying is that I need Your help. And I'm trusting in what You did for me on the cross. I'm trusting in Your sacrifice. And really what we're saying is that I know Him. I know Him. And He fills me up. He gives me what I need. Really what we're saying is He's all I need. Man might fail us. Life may let us down. But God never will. So today as we come to the Lord's table, I just want us to kind of be prepared. The Bible tells us that we come to the Lord's Supper, that we prepare our hearts. And in just a moment, I'm going to ask you to close your eyes, bow your head, and to just maybe ask God to begin to clean up some of the messes, some of the junk inside. We talked about the comparison trap. That's some mess that happens down in here. We need God to clean that up. Maybe for you, it's a sin that you just can't get a hold of. And it kind of keeps popping up. Would you ask God to clean that up? Because that's what God is great at. When we make messes, He's fantastic at cleaning those up. So in just a moment, I'm going to ask you to clean up those messes and just talk to Him about your life. But then thank Him. I mean, thank Him for what He did on the cross. Thank Him for the sacrifice that He made for us. It was an amazing act of love that He had for us. Maybe today you've never come into a relationship with Christ. Would you do that before we take the Lord's Supper? Would you simply in your own heart and mind say, Father, I'm a sinner, but today I'm putting my faith and trust in You. Save me a place in heaven when I die. When you do that, you're part of the family of God. You're an heir. You're a child. And you know for sure that you're going to heaven when you die. So if you would, let's go ahead and bow our heads together and close our eyes. And just for the next few moments, I'm going to get quiet. And would you talk to God? And that may be weird for you. Maybe you've never done it this way. But would you just talk to Him? As a friend would to a friend. Ask Him to clean up the messes of your life. And then spend some time thanking Him for what He did for you on the cross. In just a moment, I'm going to ask you to stand up. You can keep your heads bowed and eyes closed for a moment. And we're going to stand up and we're going to come to the Lord's table. And there's bread that represents Christ's body, and then there's juice that represents His blood. And really, when we take the Lord's Supper, what we're really saying is that I want Christ ingested in my life. That I don't want it to be surface or shallow, but I want it to be ingested, and I want Him to be part of me. And so you'll take the bread and you'll take the juice. You can do it up front if you want to, or you can go back to your seat. You can do it with your family, or you can do it alone. Either way, whatever you want to do, but we'll give you a few minutes to do that, and then we'll come back and pray. But I just pray this morning that this will be a special time for you as you spend time with the God of the universe. Let's stand up now, and as the Lord leads you, why don't you come up and take the Lord's Supper?
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my hope and peace, nothing but the blood.
I first believed.
God, we do thank you at how amazing your grace is. It's unimaginable for us that you would give up your life for us. When we needed you the most, you died for our sin. And you died for our struggles, and you died for our issues and our problems and our challenges. And God, we're so appreciative of that. Without that, we would all be doomed. But God, with that, you bring about so much hope and so much joy. And today, God, we're just so excited about the cross and how you changed the trajectory of our life. So God, let us live lives worthy of you. Let us please you and let you be the one who commends us. And it wouldn't be about how we're measuring up with people. God, how we're measuring up to you. And how we honor you and we please you with our life. So God, I thank you for this moment today, this special moment, as we go back 2,000 years ago to the cross. Again, we're so thankful for what you did there. We're grateful. In Christ's name, amen. All right. What a great day. You glad to be here? We've got a couple of announcements, Pastor Glenn.
We do. Pastor Jody, awesome job. Let's encourage him for bringing us the message today. And also, Sherry and Sandy and the team of volunteers that put together the Lord's Supper, could you give them a hand of encouragement as well? And we do have a few announcements. Group signups this week. The hanging table right out there in the atrium. You can find out more about groups included in those groups. The new FPU and
Legacy.
What's the other one called? Legacy.
Yeah.
Those are launching soon, and there's a preview tonight. If you'd like to be a part of that, let them know out there at the table so that they can know how to plan for you. Follow me. Training has begun. We had some great trainings last week. We have one tonight at 6. We have the final training Wednesday at 6:30. The men's Bible study has just been awesome, the third Monday of every month. Tomorrow's the third Monday, but it's Labor Day, so we're just going to not do the men's Bible study tomorrow. So don't plan on showing up tomorrow. We'll start back up again in October.
That's right.
For the men's Bible study. And then people have been asking about the Morrow campus, and I tell you, it's just been awesome to see our church meet that need there and get involved. But we've got a video update from Pastor Neil on the For Clayton campaign. Check it out.
Hey guys, it's Pastor Neil. I have something exciting I want to show you here at the Morrow building. As we head towards this set of double doors that I showed you last time, you will get to see Yeah, that's exciting, isn't it? We have a temporary setup in our new room, and we're able to have service in here now, but the project is not complete. We still have to build a stage and furnish and carpet the room. We've gotten as far as we have on this project because of your generosity, and we would ask that you will just continue to partner with us and help us finish this project. Thank you so much for being a part of the We Are For Clayton project.
I think Pastor Neil must have bought a selfie stick.
Yeah.
They're doing reggae church, and Pastor Neil has a selfie stick. They got some things going on up there.
Hey, it's great stuff happening in Mara, and you guys have done a phenomenal job. You've just invested in what we're doing. We just want to get them over the hump. They're meeting in that space, but it's not really well, what do you call it? There's no chairs or
it's very
what do you call that?
Bare,
basic.
Rudimentary, basic, yes.
Perfect. Thank you, Mr. Dictionary.
I don't know.
Thesaurus, it might be better. No, but we need to get them over the hump. There's a card in your bulletin, looks just like this. If you'd like to help them, that would be fantastic as they just kind of finish that up there, and you would be a blessing to those people. So anyway, if you could take a look at that card and put that in the offering plate when it comes by. You ready to take the offering?
Yep.
All right, let's pray. Father, we thank you for giving to us so graciously. Lord, I pray that we'll give back to you in the same manner today. In Christ's name, amen.